We're glad you're here. We welcome everyone to our worship service here at Maysville. And if you're visiting with us, we encourage you to be back with us if you can. We have our next time of service is Wednesday evening at 7. We have our Bible study here. And we have some good lessons that are brought to in various ways to various ages. And so we can accommodate your needs in that regard and in anything else you may need. So please come back and be with us when you can. Tonight we'll be led in opening prayer by Matt Weaver, our closing prayer by Howell Todd. If you'll take a song book and turn to number 872, will be our opening song in just a few moments. Carrie will lead that, and then Tim Jordan will have our scripture in just a moment. I want to remind the teachers, if you didn't hear this morning, if you're a teacher, your materials for the next quarter, for this coming quarter, is located in the teacher's workroom and ready for you to pick up, so make sure you grab those. If you're a member of the Honduras team, don't forget to bring your forms and your deposit in, and the deadline for that is January the 15th. No updates on the sick, but continue to remember those that are mentioned in our bulletin. Tom Horn, who will be traveling to Birmingham tomorrow, let's keep him in our prayers. And Matt Holder, who is recovering at home after spending several days in the hospital. And Wahila Howell, who's been moved to assistance facility, and she would appreciate visits and cards if you can get there. Prime timers, remember you have a covered dish fellowship Tuesday night at 5:30 here in the fellowship hall. And scrapbook meeting, that already happened. In the bridal shower, there's a bridal shower for Allie Hollingsworth and Ethan Knox, and that's Sunday, January the 24th at 2 o'clock here at the building. Let's begin our worship with scripture, Tim.
This evening's scripture comes from Hebrews chapter 10. We'll read verses 16 through 25. Hebrews 10, 16 through 25. This is the covenant that I will make with them. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws upon their heart, and upon their mind I will write them. And their sins and their lawless deeds, now where there is forgiveness of these things, there is no longer any offering for sin. Since, therefore, brethren, we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he inaugurated for us through the veil, that is his flesh. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a sincere heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful, and let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near.
Bow me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for another opportunity to come and worship you here on this first day of the week. Lord, we're thankful most of all for the gift of your Son and the sacrifice that he gave for the entire world to give us the hope of salvation with you one day. Lord, we're thankful for this church and all that meet here. Ask you to be with the leaders of our congregation, Lord. Help them to just seek you first in everything that they do and give them the strength and the courage to do what's best to strengthen your kingdom. Lord, we ask you to be with those who have been mentioned as sick and in need of healing. A special prayer, Lord, for Tom and Sandra as they travel tomorrow. Ask you to be with them and in the procedures that will be done. Be with Tom and those that attend to him. Lord, we're thankful for this country that we live in, the many blessings that we have that so many others don't have. Ask you to be with our leaders and help them to want to strive to look towards you and seek your guidance in the things that they decide, and always help them to try and do things that will please you. Lord, we ask you to be with us as we start a new week, as we go to our jobs, go to school, whatever we may be doing, Lord, and help us to keep you first and to do things that will bring glory to your name. Lord, we ask you to be with those who may not be here tonight, who can't be, or those who chose not to be. Lord, we know that you know people's hearts, and ask you to be patient with those who may have chose not to, and for those who can't, to hopefully let them come back with us if it be your will. Lord, please forgive us for our sins and keep us safe as we go home tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We'll sing this through a couple of times. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life that I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me, gave himself for me. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless. Trying to find out where to breathe in that song, but it's got a great message in it. 444, nailed to the cross. We'll do the first and the last stanzas of this, please.
There was one who was willing to die in my
Seventy-eight. That would be just a few more days, and that is, we'll sing the first and the last of this one.
Just a few more days to be filled with praise and to tell the old, old story. Then the twilight falls and my Savior calls, I shall him in glory. I'll extend
829, Mansion Over the Hilltop. We'll do the first and the last. I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, a little silver and a little gold, but in that city where the ransom will shine, I want a gold one and silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where they'll never grow old. And someday yonder we'll never more wander, but walk the streets that are purest gold. Don't think me poor or deserted or lonely. I'm not discouraged, I'm heaven bound. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a room and a crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow. And someday mark, if you will, 454. That'll be our song of encouragement tonight after our lesson this evening. 454. Now number 300. Number 300, we'll do the first and the last stanzas. If you'd like to, please stand. We'll sing it together.
I will sing of my Redeemer and His wondrous love to me.
We're thrilled this evening to have a visiting missionary with us. He's going to speak to us and bring us a report on the work that's going on in Tanzania, one of the Tanzania works that we support. Adam Hacias is here. Unfortunately, his family couldn't be here with us. He is married. His wife's Katie. They have two children, Madeline Jane and Francis Martin. Madeline's four and Francis one. Young family. And Adam arrived Saturday night and or Saturday afternoon, spent the evening with us, so we've been spending some time with him and getting to know him, and it's been a pleasure. Adam and Katie met at the Rochester College. Now, this is in Michigan, where Adam earned a degree in secondary education and Katie earned a degree in biblical studies. Adam worked as a math teacher and basketball coach at Rochester High School there in Michigan for a few years before they moved as a family to Abilene, Texas, where they trained with the Halbert Institute of Missions. Now, when Adam arrived, he stepped out of the car and he had on a jacket had Michigan on it and not Michigan State. I was glad to see that since I have Alabama paraphernalia all hung all over the walls of my house. So we got off to a good start. He said he was glad the results were what they were on that game. So without any further ado, Adam, you want to?
Good evening. It's good to be down here with you all. I'm glad Steve sort of explained that situation. I was worried that when you all heard I was from Michigan that I might be coming down here with hard feelings about the wallop that the Crimson Tide put on the Spartans 38-0 on New Year's Eve, but I assure you I was just as pleased as all of you Alabama fans were about that. And I understand that there's a big game tomorrow night, Roll Tide. That's the first time I've ever said that, probably the last time I'll say it. But it's really good to be down here with you all for this weekend. As Steve introduced, my family and I, we do mission work in Tanzania, East Africa, in a town called Tabora. And you're all probably thinking, that's great, but what does that have to do with our congregation? Well, Steve explained a little bit. When we left for Tanzania in 2013, September of 13, we left with about 70% of our funds raised, but we knew it was time to go. We were confident that the Lord was going to provide the rest of what we needed. And that first month in September, we were getting monthly reports from our church about our contributions, and we saw Maysville Church of Christ in Gurley, Alabama, $500 per month. And we thought, we don't know why this money is coming in. We haven't contacted Maysville Church of Christ in Gurley, Alabama. But sure enough, we found out that, you guys, that was intentional. We had first thought that, well, maybe this is just a bunch of angels sending us checks. Maybe this church doesn't exist, and that's what we had like to think. But sure enough, when we came back for our first furlough this past October, I got a hold of Steve. He called me back in December after I left a message, and he said, we've been doing that. That's intentional, and we got you on the budget for next year, too. So I knew that I needed to come down, at least myself. Unfortunately, my kids and my wife couldn't come with me, but it's been a good weekend. I'm really excited to share with you all a little bit about our family and our team and what the Lord is doing in Tabora, Tanzania. On the 10-hour drive down here, I was just kind of filled with joy and thankful and realizing really the magnitude of what's happening here. You know, me as a Michigander, I have no business being down here in the great state of Alabama. I've never been to Alabama until last night when I rolled in. But I realize that's happening, and I'm here in front of you all because of what the Lord has done and how he's brought us together. And he's taking a work that's happening on the other side of the world, and he's called me and my family to be there on the ground, and he's called this church to partner with us in that work. And that's really just amazing to me that you all would otherwise be, we would be strangers, but because of our Lord Jesus Christ, we're able to be together and we can call ourselves, we're all under one family with Jesus Christ as the head. And so I just praise him for that. Before I get into the presentation that I have for these slides, let's go ahead and pray together. Lord, I'm so thankful for tonight and the chance to talk about what you're doing in our life and in the lives of the Tanzanians in Tabora. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for Maysville. Thank you for these people, your children. I just pray that you prepare our hearts to hear, to accept what you have ready for us tonight. And please use me as your instrument. In Jesus' name, amen. So first, a little bit about our family. This is Katie and me in our dating years. We met in 2005 at Rochester College, which is a suburb of Detroit. Rochester Hills is a suburb of Detroit. And so these are pictures during our dating years. You can kind of see the Oklahoma t-shirt in there. Don't worry about that. I think I got that on sale for like a buck or something. So I'm not an OU fan. But we dated for 3 years. And Rochester College, I wonder if anybody's heard of Rochester College. It's a Church of Christ college, but okay, a few, very good. A lot of people in Rochester Hills haven't heard of Rochester College. When I was there are about 1,000 students there now. When I attended there, I graduated in 07. There were about 500 of us. So a really tiny school, but a great school. I had a great time there, and of course, it worked out. Meeting my wife there, we got married in 2008. In Vermontville, Michigan, you can kind of see it's a picture of my wife's aunt's yard is where we got married. We had a perfect day. A lot of people said I couldn't pull off the white tux, but I think I did. I think both of us were looking pretty good that day. So we've been married now 7 years, 7.5 years. It's been great. And in 2011, we had our first child, Maddie. She's 4 already, 4.5, which is crazy. And Katie, even with her being the first kid and all the, you know, when they're infants, I've seen a lot. I saw a lot of little kids in the early service today. A lot of new parents, young parents. You all know with me that those first few months are rough. There's not a lot of sleep going on. But Katie was just a trooper. Never complained. Was always doing what needed to be done. So she was great. But my approach, I chose to take a more relaxed approach to parenting. There were a lot of, that's just 3 of them. There were a lot of days where Maddie and I were just kind of cuddling, taking a nap on the couch. So that's sort of how I slept through those first couple years of her life. But it was good. And then we moved in 2013, as I said, to Tabora. Francis, our son, we had him in Dar es Salaam in 2014 in October. So he just turned 1 this past October. And you can see Maddie there with him. She is just a great older sister to him, and in return, he just adores his older sister, and he's getting to the point now where he's been walking for a few months, and with that, he's getting into trouble, and that includes sort of getting in on Maddie's playtime and times that she doesn't always want to, but overall, she is great with him, and it's just a joy to see them play together. So there's our family in a nutshell. We've been September of 2013, that means about 2 years we've been in Tanzania. And a lot of times the question that we get, and it's a good question, is why Tabora? Why would you go to this place in the middle of Tanzania, a country in the middle of East Africa? Why would you go there specifically? And for our team, the story, we did a lot of research in East Africa, and we chose East Africa because all of us had done an internship in East Africa, so we really had a heart for that part of the world. And so when we did our research to pick a place together, we knew we wanted to be somewhere in those countries. We looked at Mozambique and Tanzania and Kenya and different places. Tabora was among those. And after we did the research on the 8 or 10 different places, none of them really stood out, according to the research, because they're all places in need. They all had pros and cons for living there, different conditions. But after doing that initial research, we sort of went back and combed through the advice and the things that we heard from former missionaries who had done work in East Africa. And many of them had done survey trips in Tabora and had taken interns to Tabora. Even starting in the mid-80s, we had learned that there were missionaries that were praying for Tabora to receive missionaries. So that was about almost 30 years of prayer for this place. It was a place, Tabora, that was described as isolated and neglected. You can kind of see it's more towards the western side of the country, just south of Lake Victoria there. But it's really, for that part of the country, sort of a central hub. But the roads had not been connected to the rest of the country, so it was described as isolated, neglected, a place that really needed work to be done. And after reviewing all of those things that we heard, we realized that our team that God had formed was an answer to those prayers. And so that day we said, okay, we're gonna go to Tabora. And that was back in, we committed as a team in 2008, and we left in 2013, so it was 5 years of preparation. But finally, we arrived. We spent 2.5 months in Dar es Salaam, which is on the coast. It's the major city there in Tanzania. And we spent that time as we were waiting for vehicles and government procedures to check out. We spent that time getting right into language learning. And so this is me with my first tutor, who's become a friend, Joas. We spent 3 hours a day just doing language, practicing language, learning things from him. We found other tutors. So that was basically our full-time job those first 2.5 months while we were in Dar. And really for the first year, that's what we did. That was our job. Thankfully, there was no pressure, no expectation to get into the villages and start doing things before we were ready. So we were really able to just spend 40 hours a week just with vocab cards and books and practicing our skills in the market and with our tutors. And so by the time we left last January 2015 for the village, we had a really good base, and we had enough where we were able to hit the ground running, so to speak, and really get into the lessons that we wanted to teach. As far as our team, it's our family and one other family. We're a two-family team. And in short, our goals are to evangelize and plant churches and then disciple the people who want to be a part of those churches. And so those are stated goals. Those are the things that we're working towards out in the villages around Tabora. And our strategy, even in just this first year of being in the village, has changed quite a bit. We started out by trying to gather, plan, and announce and gather big groups to be a part of these mini church services where we would sing songs and then do a Bible lesson and our plan was to, through the weeks, to tell the story of the Bible, basically, starting in Genesis and getting all the way through Acts. And we had it all laid out. After 15 weeks, everybody was going to accept Christ as their Savior. Everybody was going to want to be baptized and just be all gung-ho about it, and we were going to open a church that 16th week, and everybody was just going to be fired up. We thought, you know, we've planned to do this for 8 to 10 years, but we'll be done in 4. This will be a piece of cake. And we found out pretty fast it doesn't work that way. We sort of, I think, overestimated our being white and just sort of assuming that, oh, everybody's going to want to know what these white people have to say. And really, that was sort of ignorant and maybe a bit arrogant on our part to think that, because these people, you know, they have their lives, and they need to farm their crops, and they need to take care of their families. And that doesn't mean that they can just sit around all day waiting for these white people to show up and then soak up every word. You know, they got their own lives to worry about. And so after learning that, after the first few months, we changed our strategy to focus more on individuals and really building relationships with these people. Because we were getting people to come to these meetings, but we weren't getting to know any of them. And so we would have a great hour with them of singing and teaching a lesson, and that would be it. And we would just go back home. So we really focused on, after a few months, getting to know people and going to their houses and spending time with them one-on-one in order to build relationships and then figure out how the Lord wanted to use that relationship to reveal Christ to them. And so, and as I'll talk about a little bit later, we found some success with that, and we praise God for that. Before I talk about a couple other things, I do want to show a video that we took the very first day that we had baptisms. We baptized 5 people in one of these villages called Uyega, and it was an exciting day. It was the first time that we had done baptisms as a team. It was the first time that I personally had baptized anybody. And so, and my wife, who is great with this technology stuff, had the little iPod with her and took video. And so I want to share that all with you, because it was an exciting day, and I want to share that excitement with you.
as I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old...
I went down in the river to pray, studying about sawa. Sasa kubatizwe katika jina la Baba na la Mwana na la Roho Mtakatifu.
Amen.
Hongera.
Sasa naomba tusikilizane. Tazameni, hawa ndugu wamekufa na kufufuka pamoja na Yesu Kristo. Wamekuwa viumbe vipya katika Yesu. Sasa niwaulize nyie mashahidi swali moja. Nyinyi nyote ni mwili moja katika Yesu Kristo. Mna jukumu la kuwapenda na kuwaombea na kuwajibisha hawa ndugu zenu. Je, mnakubali jukumu hili?
Ndio.
Bwana Yesu asifiwe.
Amen.
Naomba tuombe. Baba yetu uliye mbinguni, asante kwa ajili ya leo na sasa.
Really praise God for days like those. But unfortunately, and as you might guess, not every day looks like that. They're not all days of celebration for every day that we have like that. There are many days where we have different challenges to the work in different capacities, not the least of which is car trouble. This was back in January, I think just the first or second week that we had started. January is part of the rainy season in Tabora. And you can see that pond that's kind of on the back side of the car there. That's not a pond, that's the road. And so what I was trying to do, quite stupidly, was to ride on the grass about 100 feet. I had stopped the car about 100 feet before where you see the car is now. And I asked my teammate who was with me, "What do you think? Should we just go around it? It doesn't look like, the grass looks like it's dry." And before I gave him a chance to answer, I put it into first gear and just hit it, and that's what happened. And I can even admit, maybe I shouldn't, but I did this a second time a few months later, not learning my lesson. And then finally, a good friend of mine, a colleague over in a different town, said the golden rule is you don't drive on green, you don't drive on grass. And so I finally figured that out after twice. But so you can see I stuck us there pretty well. But when you do that over there, you don't call AAA, you don't call a tow truck. We're just in the middle of nowhere here. So you probably ask yourself what you do. Well, you find as many Tanzanians who will help you to get the car out. And thankfully, this was in the middle of nowhere, but there was a village not too far. There were some people on their bikes riding by. They agreed to go get help from this village. This many guys came back, about 10 of them, and we spent the next few hours trying to problem solve and get this car out of this mud. And what they did, it was really quite brilliant. They used the spare tire as a fulcrum, and they chopped down some tree trunks, and they sort of shaved off one end and used that as a lever and got some leverage from the spare tire. And the guy right there bending down next to the car was sticking things underneath, branches and leaves and stuff, under the tire while everybody else was lifting the car up with the lever. And so we did that around all four tires, and eventually we got out. So thankfully, that worked out. But another blessing that came out of that, we were on our way to a different village, and the village that these guys are from, Kawekapina, for several weeks, we were driving right through their village to get to the other village we intended on going to. And in these few hours that we were stuck, we got to talk with them, and we realized that in Kawekapina, in their village, they didn't have a church, and they didn't have hardly any Christians at all. And so on our way back, we stopped in their village. We got permission from their village leaders, and every week since that day, we've been working with people in Coacapina and evangelizing and spreading the gospel that way. And I just praise God for that, even though we were driving through a village without even stopping to find out in order to get to another place. You know, God used this, which looked like a horrible and seemed like a horrible situation that day. He used that to shift our focus where it needed to be and say politely and lovingly to us, no, you boneheads, you're missing a place that is ready to hear my word. And so we've been able to be there now for months and establish relationships with a few Tanzanians in Coacapina that I'm confident will be fertile ground for the word of Christ to spread. Another challenge that we're up against is, I sort of touched on it when I was talking about our whiteness, is just a general sense of apathy and non-interest. And I think this is a challenge for us Christians all over the world. I'm sure it is here in Alabama. I know it is in Detroit, and it's certainly the case in Tabora too, where people just, some of them are not ready yet. They're concerned with the things of this world. They're concerned, they're preoccupied with their own lives. They're concerned with putting food on the table for their families. And so we really had to, more than we expected, really had to pray and really had to work on different people and push on different people to really find out who are the few that God is ready to work on. And so that's been something that we've had to work through in this first year. Another challenge, unfortunately, has been issues with other Christians and other denominations there in those villages. You might think here that I would say, you know, Muslims are a big challenge, or the witch doctors, or pagans, and that just hasn't been the case at all. The truth is, all of those other groups have been very welcoming. Some of our best friends are Muslims in the villages, but the place where we've gotten the most pushback has been from other denominations. In one village, Kasandalala, we were using a small building that was being used as a church building on Sundays, but we were going there on Fridays to gather people and have lessons and services with them and worship times with them. And one day, somebody came in on a picky, which is a motorbike. He came in during the worship from a small town 25 minutes away, and he said, "You can't be doing this. This building is used for our denomination. And so you need to find another place to do this." Back in Coacapina, we were meeting there every Thursday, and we had some Christians coming from pretty far, especially on foot and on bikes, to be a part of our gatherings on those Thursday afternoons. And after a few weeks, they were told by their church leaders, "No, you're not allowed to go back there anymore. Those white people are very bad, and they're going to lie to you and steer you wrong," even though we had never met them or even knew who they were. And so that's sort of been an unfortunate thing that we have encountered, but it just gives us all the more desire to instill in these churches that we're planting the idea that, you know, anybody who confesses the Lord as their Savior, they're to be considered our brothers and sisters. And so that's something that we've learned and taken away from these experiences that we hope to instill in our churches. Another challenge, which may be more unique to Tanzanian culture and East African culture, maybe African culture as a whole, is their approach to religion. And what I think of to describe this sort of approach that they have is a charm bracelet. And a lot of Tanzanians in their culture will sort of treat Christianity as a charm on their charm bracelet. So that when there's a problem, when somebody gets sick, when they need something, they will go to the pastor, they'll go to the church to pray to God and to ask for help, for healing, whatever it may be. But if that charm doesn't work in the way that they expect it to or want it to, they'll try the next charm on their bracelet. They'll go to the mosque and talk to the Muslim leader in the mosque and ask for prayer from them. They'll still go to the witch doctor and ask for something from the witch doctor in order to get whatever it is that they want. And so we really want to show these new Christians that we're working with, these new Christians that we're discipling, you know, when you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, Jesus is your only Lord and Savior. And you don't look to these other things, these things of the world, in order to get healing or whatever help you need. We trust in God and God alone. And so that's been a challenge that that we have come up against, and that really we're excited about teaching as we disciple these new Christians. Another challenge is just discipling in general. And maybe challenge puts too negative of a tone on that, but the truth is, when you are really responsible for, you know, the faith of someone to whom you've evangelized, you find out quite quickly that, you know, it doesn't end at baptism. You know, baptism, we certainly thank God for those days and we're excited about those days, but that doesn't mean, you know, Satan is going to be like, oh, well, I guess he's baptized now. Oh, well, he's going to do great. It doesn't work that way. In the same way, just because we decided to go to Tanzania, Satan hasn't left us alone. We all know how he is, how he tries to, every step of the way, throw barriers in the way that are going to throw us off the course. And that's certainly been the case with the new Christians whom we're working with. So we realize that baptism isn't the end of the story. That doesn't mean happily ever after. Baptism is the springboard to be able to begin to live with them and teach them the life and what it means to live within the kingdom of God. And really, that is a challenge that I'm really excited about. I think maybe at the beginning of our 2 years, certainly at the beginning of going into these villages, that may have seemed something that would be discouraging to me. But now that we've gotten to the point where we have relationships with these people, it's exciting to me. It gets me fired up to realize that now I have the opportunity to, inside this discipleship, inside this discipling them, I get to live with them what it means to be the kingdom of God together. And we get to do that as a community. And I'm really excited about that opportunity. And so it seems more an opportunity and less a challenge now that we have those relationships with our friends over there. I just want to talk about a couple specific stories that we've had in this first year being in the village. This is Michael. He is the first person I've ever baptized. And beginning in January, he was with us every step of the way. We were going to his village once a week, and he even came with us to a different village another day of the week just to hear what we had to preach, and he was just soaking it all up and even teaching other people around him, which is exactly what we envisioned and everything that we had hoped for with the people that we worked with. He was just really on fire, you could say, for what we brought. But we realized quite quickly, he was in the video, that was baptism day back in April, that, as I just mentioned, this, baptism isn't the end of the story. And discipleship is so important, because we quickly learned after that baptism, he sort of disappeared and went to another town for a month. He had some family things to do. And we quickly learned when he came back, we were hearing other stories from our friends in his village, even in a neighboring village, that he was doing things that, you know, we're not supposed to do as Christians in this new life. And so he sort of struggled with learning and coming along and maturing in his faith and really grasping what it means to be a Christian and the things that you denounce when you become a Christian, and really what it means to live out this life, this new life that is made possible in Christ. And so he is sort of an example of that challenge and that opportunity to really disciple these people, and a reminder that we need to have grace and mercy for our new baby brother and sister Christians, that they need help and they need encouragement, they need correcting at times, and that we need to really be patient with them and not give up on them and have the grace that God has had for us for people like that who don't quite yet understand what it means to be followers of Christ. So that's Michael, and I guess if I had even just one prayer request, it would be to pray for Michael that we'll be able to, that God will use us to speak to him and bring him along in his faith. And then the other story is Lugila, and this is the exciting rah-rah story, I guess, that we have for our first year. Lugila, another unfortunate thing that happened was the place that we were trying to get to when I stuck the car was Lugila. And we couldn't get there because of the rainy season. The rainy season, we couldn't get there until June. And so in June, we tried to schedule times to go there. It ended up that not until the middle of July could we go to Lugila to finally visit these people that have been waiting for us for so long. We had a friend in their village who had actually received official Bible training and Bible education, which is pretty rare for village people there in Tanzania as a whole, and someone that we had really trusted and proved that he was knowledgeable. And so we asked him in that time, while we couldn't get there, for him to teach them and go there every week in order to continue feeding these people who were obviously ready to hear the gospel. And we found out when we got there in July that this friend of ours, at that time, he should have been there at least 12 times. He showed up a total of 2 times and was taking money that we were giving him for expenses, for his motorbike, for gas, for food. He was taking it for other things. And so he really sort of hung these people out to dry. But when we got there in July, we spent a couple nights out there that weekend. That Sunday, we had our first official Sunday gathering, worship service, if you want to call it that. And since then, up until the time that we left in October, every Sunday, we met with those people in Lugila. And at this point, on a given Sunday, when I say this church, I'm talking about maybe 12 to 15 adults and then a lot of kids there too. But you can just tell, you can just see it. It's palpable, it's tangible how hungry these people are for the gospel. And it's clearly a fertile ground. It's clearly a place that the Lord has been just ready to work for who knows how long now. And they are just soaking up everything, even though they don't understand yet, even everything that we're teaching them, they're just hungry. And they've elected leaders. And the last week before we left for furlough, they wanted to build a church building, just a small building, nothing fancy. And they were sort of procrastinating, and maybe we were telling them for a few months that, you know, we're leaving in October and we'll be back in a few months, but we're going to be gone. And they said, okay, you know, we want to have a building done before you guys leave. Maybe they thought we were joking that we weren't going to leave because they weren't doing anything. And that my final week there, I said, okay, this is my last time. I'll see you guys in a few months. And my teammate Garrett was going to be there the following week. In between my last week and Garrett's last week, they had burned all the bricks and they had built all the bricks up. And all they needed was the roof that we told them we were going to help them purchase. And so in 1 week, and it's certainly not a building as nice as this one, but it's a place that they can be proud of and a place that gives them their identity as a church, as something that is relevant, something that is reputable, something that gives them some respect in the eyes of their peers. And all of that because of this foundation that we have in Jesus Christ. And so we praise God for that too. When we've baptized maybe 20, 25, 30 people in Lugila, and one of the guys, it was a hole that was far away from all the houses, and so on our walk back after I baptized this one older gentleman, I asked him, you know, how you feeling now? And he says, you know, I feel great. And he said something that we had never alluded to, we had never mentioned, we had never used it as an analogy about what baptism is and what it means to put on Christ. But he said, you know, there's just been a darkness over Lugila. And I can feel that darkness lifting with the message that you guys are bringing us. And so when something like that happens, when completely unprovoked, a Tanzanian who lives way out in the middle of nowhere uses that sort of language, you can tell that the Holy Spirit is working there. And so we praise God for that. Now, I want to wrap up with just a couple more things. This furlough and coming back and speaking with individuals in different churches, I've sort of thought about, you know, what the Lord has been doing through our team and through me. I've come to realize that we all have our stories, but even from time to time, we all sort of have a theme of those few weeks or few days or few months or whatever God is doing through us. And I've realized that my theme and my song, my story, it kind of goes along with one scripture in particular, and that's in Matthew chapter 16, verse 25. I'm just going to read that quickly, just one verse, Matthew 16, 25. These are the words of Jesus, and he says, "For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. But whoever loses their life for me will find it." Before any of this happened, before any of the moving to Tabora, to Tanzania, before leaving my teaching job at Rochester High, during that time, and I had a great teaching experience there. I worked in a great school with great kids, with great colleagues, but I just knew that that wasn't where I was supposed to be. And so I was praying to God, you know, God, I want more. Show me what it is that you want me to do, and I'll do it. And God, being who he is, he called me out on that. He said, okay, if you're serious, move to East Africa. Join this team. Go to Tabora. We'll see how serious you are about wanting that next step. And so me, maybe in my stubbornness, maybe I thought for whatever reason I was going to call God on his bluff. I said, okay, I'm going to do it. And I was kind of like, kind of feeling out God. Now, okay, I said I was going to do it. You can take it away now. I said I was going to go. Now let me feel more comfortable here doing my teaching job. That's nice and comfortable. And he laid his cards out and he said, yeah, you're going. That's what I got in store for you. And this is the scripture that he laid on my heart. Whoever loses their life for me will find it. And so we went. We've been there 2 years. We've had these experiences, these great days, these baptism days. We've had the challenges. It hasn't been easy. But my theme of my life right now, the story of my life right now, the message that God has given me to share on this furlough coming back with individuals, with churches, with you all today. And I don't say this as your preacher. I don't say this as any preacher. I'm a math teacher. But I can tell you as a fellow witness to the love of Christ that promise is real. That if you lose your life for the sake of Christ, you will find true life. And for you all, that probably doesn't mean moving to Tabora, Tanzania. Though we're always open to teammates. So let me know. Come talk to me after the service. We'd love to have you. But it probably doesn't mean that for you. But what I want to urge you to do is figure out in your life what God wants you to give up for him so that he can show you true life. And what I have found in these 2 years is that true life is simply just holding hands with a fellow brother in Christ, a Tanzanian, someone who would otherwise be a stranger. That's where eternal life is, in that community with somebody who I can call my brother because of what Jesus Christ did for us. And I encourage you to find that in your life wherever that may be. Let's go ahead and pray. Lord, I'm so thankful for this opportunity again. I'm so thankful for the story that you've given me and this message to share with my fellow brothers and sisters. Thank you for working through me and through our team. Thank you for using this church and my fellow brothers and Christians to support this work. I just thank you. And as we move forward, especially in this new year, 2016, I pray that you'll lay upon the hearts of everybody here what it is that you are begging them to give up, so that you can show them real life and the life that you want them to find. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you're someone who wants that deeper life, who wants to find that eternal life and you feel like you haven't yet, I encourage you to come up as we stand and as we sing.
Tonight and a genuine effort on you and your family's part to spread the gospel, and I know God's going to continue to bless you there and open doors for you. And your message tonight certainly gives us something to think about as well in our lives here and what we can do to impact others. 387 will be our closing song in a few minutes. 387. We have the Lord's Supper prepared this evening. If you'd like to partake of it, you make your way back to the foyer and you'll be shown where you can be served. Again, if you're visiting, we thank you for being here. Hope you can stick around, let us talk to you a little bit and get to know you better. Let us know if we can otherwise help you out. 387, we'll have our closing prayer after this.
Lead me to some soul today, oh, teach me, Lord. What to say, friend of mine, are lost in sin and cannot find their way. Few there are who seem to care, and
Blessed Father, we're grateful to you for all that you are, all the blessings that you provide us in our lives. We're mindful of your majesty and we praise your name. We know that we don't deserve all the blessings you afford us, your marvelous love and the demonstration that you made in sending that most precious gift of your Son to be tortured and slain, that we might be drawn back to you, no longer separated from sin. Father, help us to remember each day just how blessed we are, to keep in mind that this life is but a sojourn. Help us to be focused on doing your will, being good stewards of all those things that you afford us. We pray that you will continue to bless the work that Adam and his family and the others are doing there in Tanzania. Bless those new brothers and sisters in Christ. Help them to grow and become mature as they strive to do your will. Father, help us here as we go about our lives to find those who are seeking to know the truth. Help us to open their eyes and give them that understanding of your true light. Help us to be light to them. We also pray, Father, for those of our number and those that we know and love that have great struggles. Bless them and help them to overcome those obstacles, whether it be great loss, whether it be physical or other distress. Help them to be strong and to look to you for guidance. Also pray that you will bless those who sacrificially reach out and bless and touch those who are in need. Father, continue to afford us that marvelous cleansing through your Son. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.